everybody. Welcome to this meeting today. We are very lucky to have Wing Commander Prakash Rao retired. He has been an ace helicopter pilot, and not only a very good pilot, but also the engineering aspect of flying. Various, as you know, the dynamics of flight. And he's going to now compare, I suppose, the man-made flying and the natural bird flights, and how it affects. He's going to write a book also. So he's working on a lot of these aspects of this. In fact, when I requested him to talk to us, he gave a program for 3 hours. So I said, Bahubali, please, because he has got so much data with him. So I said, Baba, please make it a little concise, say about 45 minutes or so, then we have some time for question and answers also. I'm sure you all would like to interact with him further. So without wasting any further time, Wing Commander sir, may I?
Thank you. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be here and share a little bit of knowledge that I have dwelled into during my period in the Air Force. And I am hopeful that at the end of this lecture, while you are watching the birds, you will also watch its flight. That's my aim today, and here we go. Can you have this row of birds off? Okay. Okay. Fantastic.
Yes.
Now, bird flight has always fascinated man, and now we have come so far, from 1903, from the first flight days till now. Since 1903, since the time of the first flight till now, we are 110 years hence, and we have made a lot of progress. However, there is one thing that we have not been able to do is the replication of the bird flight as such. So it is a very, very complex matter, complex subject, and probably in times to come we will be able to crack it, but as of now we are still very, very far from understanding how actually the bird is able to fly, how is it able to maneuver, how is it able to control each feather, each part of its skin. These nuances will still take a little time. So, towards this effect, the scope of my lecture today would be, to understand bird flight, I have cut down, all the jargon, the aerodynamics part of it and all that. I brought it down to a school kid level so that, all of us can comfortably understand what is there. So, but little bit of physics and associated terminology is inevitable, which I'll brush up, and we'll refresh our minds. What happened in the Newton's third law and things like that, and probably it'll be a good refresher. But thereafter, I'll take on the structure of the bird wing itself. We'll discuss flapping flight, which is the major crux of this entire thing, then how birds actually do the takeoffs and landings, and some common observations that we have all seen sometime or the other. However, we have probably not taken them to pieces, these observations. So, we'll discuss some of them here. Now, everybody is very familiar with this photograph, the fossil of the Archaeopteryx. I will not go too much into it. Basically, there are two theories as to how birds started to fly, whether it is the arboreal way or the cursorial way. Arboreal is whether they started jumping from branch to branch, okay, and then started developing wings, or cursorial means whether they started running and then use their forelimbs to gather more speed, and then how that's how the wings develop. Okay, this is the theory. Okay, next. Okay, this is little bit on biomimicry. You know, man had always wanted to mimic the birds. So he tried this in the 17th and 18th centuries. You know, you all know about those people, Montgolfier, Otto Lilienthal, and all these people. Okay, who have tried going up in the hot air balloon or trying hanging on to the wings or something. Now coming down to some theory aspects. Okay, we are all aware of the Newton's third law of motion. Okay, very clear. For every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction, and that's the theory on which the modern jet aircraft flies. Okay, now
okay, this is a model aeroplane. Okay, you can all see this. Okay, I just brought this aeroplane to show you now how the aeroplane wing is. Okay, so here I remove the wing. Now actually when I am going to talk to you and say this is the wing, okay, I am referring to this part of this, you know, the cross section of the wing that I am always talking about. This part, okay, is what is shown there. Okay, because you know, I have lot of people, when they see this is called the aerofoil structure. Okay, everybody thinks that the wing is like this. Actually, it is a cut cross section of a wing. So what I am showing you here is this portion of the wing. Okay, so now coming to various terms, here you can make out, if that was the aerofoil, this is the leading edge, this is the trailing edge. Okay, and the line joining the leading edge and the trailing edge is called the chord line. Okay, which basically determines its area, and the upper surface, the lower surface, and the blue lines that are passing over this are the airflow lines. Okay, very simple. Next. Now, the chord line we just talked about, centers of the leading edge and the trailing edge, and whatever angle that the wing takes, okay, this angle, whatever it takes from the airflow when it moves like this, okay, this angle is what is called the angle of attack. Okay, so if I am like this, this is already, when it moves through the air like this, it is already producing lift. When I increase the angle of attack this way, it will produce more lift. Okay, and lift is the force which is actually lifting the aeroplane. So there are two wings on either side of the aeroplane. So both the wings are exerting that pressure, upward pressure, that is what is carrying the entire body up. Okay. Okay, here, so the lift is perpendicular to the aerofoil, and there is another component called the drag, which is friction. Okay, we all know about friction. Okay, on the road or on in the automobiles, but even in any body moving through the air will also have friction because it's a fluid. Next. Now coming to a very very important theorem, which is the Bernoulli's theorem. It says, in any steady streamline flow of a fluid, fluid means whether it is liquid or air, both ways, both are called fluids, okay, the sum of the kinetic energy and the pressure energy, it is constant. Okay, that means wherever there is going to be more pressure energy, there is going to be lower kinetic energy, and wherever there is going to be lower kinetic energy, there is going to be more pressure energy. Okay, so let's see how this happens. Let us just imagine that there is a tube through which we have a liquid passing this way from my left to my right. Okay, and also let us imagine that there is a constriction in the tube, as shown here. So, what happens? As the fluid moves closer to the constriction, since it has to maintain, you know, the sum of the pressure and the velocity head, both must be constant. So, as it comes here, the velocity increases here, just to keep up the constant flow. This we have noticed even while watering the, you know, pie, you know, garden. You know, we always put our, you know, finger and then, you know, try to, you know, pass the water to a longer distance. Okay, we all seen this. Okay, so this is what exactly happens in the tube when there is a constriction. The speed of the tube, speed of the liquid increases. When the speed of the liquid increases or the fluid increases, automatically there is a fall in pressure. Okay, so velocity head increases, the pressure head has to come down. That's what is the Bernoulli's principle. And when it passes the constriction, again the velocity reduces and the pressure head regains to normal. Okay, so next. Now cut it off. Cut half the tube and now see what happens actually. We are having a constriction which is just moving in a fluid wherein the air is passing over it and below it. However, the one that is passing over, since there is going to be acceleration here, there is going to be fall in pressure here. Got it? With me everybody? Okay? Okay, one more thing. Anybody has any doubt, please, you can, you know, you are at liberty to please stop me, ask me, we'll clear it and then move forward. Okay? So this is what happens. So there is an accelerated flow just because there is a constriction like this. Since there is acceleration here, there is fall in pressure here. What happens now? Since there is fall in pressure here, this particular constriction, if it is not tied to any surface, it would love to rise and occupy that low pressure area. This is the basis of creating lift. This is exactly what happens in all our, you know, everything that flies in the air. Okay? Just for an example, you know, when there is a storm approaching in the villages and all these places where we have huts, you know, having this kind of roofs, you know, thatched huts we have seen, which have got this kind of roofs. When there is a strong gale, 34 knots, 60 knots, whatever, okay? There is so much of lift produced here that the roof flies away. I have seen these things happening. Okay? We play with this frisbee. Frisbee is exactly this. Next. Okay? Now coming to, okay, that same constriction I have brought here in the shape of an aerofoil, because this is, you know, over lot of experimentation, hundreds and thousands of hours in the wind tunnel and all that, we have come to a shape, you know, an optimal shape which would, you know, give us the kind of lift that we want in an aeroplane. So that is what it is. And thus, when the angle of attack of this aerofoil is raised, increased, you know, we have a pressure pattern which is a low pressure here and a constant pressure or an increased pressure here, and thus the aerofoil wants to go up to occupy the low pressure. Okay? Next. Now, come down to comparison. So, this is what I have shown you, the aircraft wing. Where the relative airflow flowing over the wing, under the wing, there is reduced air pressure, the wing wants to come up, move up. Similarly, the bird's wing, when it spreads its wing and moving, gliding along, okay, the same thing is happening here. There is reduced air pressure on top, that's why there is lift. And that's how it is able to sustain in the air. Next. Okay, this is actually, now I come down to a bird wing here. Okay, this is a cross section of the bird wing. Okay, air speeding past a bird's wing causes lift. Next. And the bird, when it raises its wing, okay, it increases its lift and thus it moves up further. Next. Okay, now you can see this. bird, you can see the shape of the wing, you can actually feel it here. Okay, the wings are not flat, they are in the shape that I have shown you there. Yeah, it's got a curvature which has got a longer boundary length on the top and a lesser boundary length of less on the bottom, and thus there is the production of lift. Okay, now forget about the equation. Okay, how, what I want to just tell you here is the lift is dependent on a very simple equation called the lift equation, CL half rho v square s. Okay, CL is coefficient of lift, rho is density of air. Okay, for the class, for today, we take that density of air is constant here, where we are talking. However, the density reduces as we go up. Okay, velocity of the airfoil and s is the surface area of the wing. Okay, now next. That means, forget about the equation here, just understand that the lift is directly proportional to the density. More the density of the air, more the lift, more the speed of the wing or the aerofoil, more the lift and more the area, more. And here the speed is, no, it is v square, it is okay, proportional to the square of the speed. That must, you must remember. Next. Similarly, we have drag, which is the opposing force, which is trying to reduce the speed of the aeroplane. That also is dependent on the same factor. That means wherever you have lift, there you have so much drag. Okay, these are brothers in arms. Next. Okay, and drag is mainly of three types: form drag, surface tension drag, lift dependent drag. Okay, form drag is, I am sitting as a pillion on a motorcycle carrying a board like this. Okay, do I carry the board this way or do I carry the board this way? This way or this way? This way. Why?
Because it cuts the air.
Yeah. Okay. I don't want to project this much area of the board to the airflow. Okay. The, you know, your motorcycle may be giving 70 kilometers per hour, but 70 kilometers per liter. It will give you just about 35 or 30 in case you will have to travel the same distance. So that is the kind of effect that it has got. So that is what. So form. The form drag. So idea is to cut down the form. Cut down the form is, you know, align yourself with the airflow.
And also
it will
push us back.
Yeah. It is that feeling is basically that. Okay. So that is what is form. First thing is, by the very existence of an object being in a fluid, it's got form drag. Second one is surface friction drag. Just because, you know, I am standing on a 10 meter board over the swimming pool, I jump or I dive, I don't go and touch the bottom. Why? Because the fluid is stopping me en route. There is friction. That is because of the fluid I am passing through, it holds me. That is exactly what is surface friction drag. Okay, similarly, even when an object is moving through air, air is trying to hold it. Okay, even if I do a free fall from, you know, 20,000 feet or 30,000 feet, the terminal velocity of a human being is just about 196 kilometers per hour. Okay, you can't go beyond that because the surface friction forces are actually stopping you from accelerating.
The thing is about the swimming pool.
Yeah.
Even if you jump on a higher velocity, but we go on to the bottom of the swimming pool.
Yeah.
At a point of time,
you
go
into
the initial.
Correct. Idea is basically why I took that example is I want to say that there is certain kind of frictional forces acting on a body that is moving through a fluid. Okay. Here you go, probably you will touch. Okay. Then comes the third form of drag, and the most important is the lift dependent drag. That means anytime an aerofoil is creating lift, there is, it is also creating drag. How it is creating drag, we will come to in the next. Okay, now I have talked about streamlining, form drag. Okay, idea is to present minimum surface to the airflow. When I put a plate to the airflow, it is resistance is 100%. However, when it is a, you know, sphere of the same area, it comes down to 50%. when it is a sphere and a cone combined, it comes down to 15%. And when it is an object similar to that of an aerofoil, it comes down to almost 5%. Okay, seen this? So this is what is aerodynamic streamline. Okay, so all our cars, bikes, you know, these speed cars and you know racing cars, everything is working on this particular subject. Next. Again, we come back to the same eagle. Okay, so look at the way it has streamlined its body. Look at the way it is tucked in its legs to the rear. It doesn't want the legs to hang like this and you know and project this much of surface area to the wind, to the airflow. So it is tucked in and just projecting only this much over there. Okay. You can all see the screen. Am I obstructing it? Next. Okay, now coming to the forces in flight. You know what happens when an aircraft is flying? It is in a constant flight. Okay, there are four forces acting on the aeroplane. The lift force is always acting against the gravity, correct? The weight is always towards the gravity. Thrust, which is being provided by the engine, always forward, and drag, which is always trying to pull it back. Okay, only when these four forces are in equilibrium will an aeroplane continue to fly straight and level. Okay, next. The same thing for the bird.
Will drag exist if we travel in vacuum?
No. However, we can't fly in vacuum because there is no wind.
There is no fluid.
There is no fluid. Okay? Good question. Okay?
Bird doesn't have a propeller.
Exactly. So, we will come to that. Okay? Now, this thrust part of it, okay, as rightly brought out. Okay? How is this thrust coming from the bird?
Through its wings.
Okay? Through its wings. Okay? So, which we will see in the subsequent slide. Now, you all have seen the birds flying, you know, gliding, doing what not, okay, at various places, you know, from in our daily lives. Okay. One is the flap and flight. Everybody is very clear what the crows do all the time, okay, very rarely they glide. Then the gliding flight, which the vultures and all these big birds, okay, they are always gliding most of the time, okay. Then flap and glide, okay, what the hornbills generally do, you know, flap and then glide for some time, again flap, or the cranes do. Then flap mounting, in which the munias and the sparrows and all the small birds, they flap for some time, then hold their wings to the body, okay, and then go down. Since they are holding their wings, they are no more, you know, producing lift. So what happens? It is the path of the bird is no more level. Try to come down, attracted to the gravity. So it will do this. And then again it will start flapping. And then again it will bound. So they do an undulated flight, something sinusoidal curve type. Okay? Then comes the soaring flight, in which the birds with all these broad wings take advantage of the rising thermals and continue to go up without flapping their wings. They are just taking advantage of the rising thermals. Okay, rising air currents. Then the hoaring flight, which the black-winged kite or the sunbirds and the hummingbirds, they are always stationary at one place, okay, even to suckle. And then there are some birds which can dive like the kingfisher and plunge into the water like the gannet or some, you know, these kind of birds. So all these are different types of flight. Now what are the requirements for flight? Okay. I listed out a few, probably there will be some more, however generally they all fall to this. We require a very light and strong structure because you know we need to get that thing airborne, get it off the ground. So we need it very light and it should be strong because it should withstand so many, you know, pressures, the air forces that are there and the, you know, when it is flying. And then it must be a streamlined body, like I told you. If the body is not streamlined, you are going to attract a lot of friction lot of friction means lot of energy. Lot of energy means you got to eat. The bird has got to eat. Okay, when I say I or you means we are all birds as of now. Okay, that's how we are. Okay, we communicate to each other. Okay, then we must have wings and feathers to, you know, get that aerodynamic shape of the wing. Then the flight paddles to propel this wings, and a navigation system to know where exactly to go. You know, I got up in the morning, I must know where to go to find my food and whatever, okay, or my destination. And then ultimately the brain, which is controlling the nervous system, which is ultimately controlling this entire phenomena. Next. Okay, it has also got, you know, the bird has also got some certain air sacs to create additional buoyancy and to give it that shape. Okay, next. Now coming to the wing. Okay, it's a bony framework composing of muscles, nerves, blood vessels, feathers, and in spite of all this, it is foldable. We'll see how beautifully it folds and, you know, creates the lift. Okay, this is the cross section of a bone cut, you know, longitudinally. Then you can see there are rakes inside which are actually supporting the bone. Now, coming to the feather. Okay, we all seen feathers. So many kinds of feathers. This, and even this. Huh? What role do they perform? Is what we want to know. Okay. Now, each feather has around, bird has got around 1000 to 25,000 feathers. May not be all like this, but various sizes and shapes. And this is called the quill, correct? This is the quill. A single strand of this is called the barb. Then there is the barbule, which is, if you actually see through a microscope, which will come next, okay? There is another branch in this strand, which is called the barbule, and then there is a hook at the end of the barbule, which is called the barbicillary. Okay, and this is made of a protein called keratin, the same that of the human nails. Okay, and the birds are continuously preening these feathers. Preening is, you know, the bird has got an oil gland, it's called the preen gland, which is at the tail. Okay. It's got, even if you know, those non-vegetarians out here who eat chicken, they can actually, you know, they may have seen it. Okay, there is a small bulb like a thing which has got an oil gland there. It secretes oil, you can actually see it. So the bird, you know, pecks there, gets some oil on its beak, and then preens these feathers. Okay, and this feather is like a velcro. Okay, like, see, you can see this all.
Yeah.
Okay, now it is, I try to break it, it's not easy to break. You can all see, I can only stretch it. Now, if I say, tear it now, yeah, I tear it. Okay, you can all see the cut. I again preen it. Okay, it's like a velcro. And there it is. So even if I move it in the air, okay, you can't see that. You can't see the tear. That's what happens. They are all, you know, self-sealing, you know, mechanism that is there in the feather. Okay. And coming to molding, the feathers, you know, have a definite life. Okay. Some birds leave all the feathers once in a season. All the feathers in one go. And that time the bird is very vulnerable, it can't fly. Okay, it selects a suitable place, a secluded place away from predators to be there and develop all its feathers and then again fly. And there are some birds which do this molting, okay, this shedding of feathers in stages.
So where is barbicillary in the picture?
Barbicillary is the hook. Yeah, this hook. Okay, like. This feather?
This is an example of a bird where it drops all the feathers in one go.
Some of the geese which fly.
Geese?
Geese, generally the geese. They drop, go into secluded.
Vulture.
Now, yeah, you can see this, a magnified image, yeah. Next. Now there are various types of feathers, the primaries, secondaries, scapulars, which are the shoulder feathers, contour feathers, which are there to give the aerodynamic shape, and the down feathers, which are inside, which are only there for insulation purposes. Okay, these down feathers, you may have seen, they are used in, you know, all our, what is it? The extreme cold climate, the clothing, okay, quilts and airbags and
filters.
Next. Yeah, it does look like a down feather, but it is actually a peacock feather.
Yeah, down feather would only
be something like this. It will be something like this minus this.
Yeah,
soft. This like this. Now, a wing, can you see here? This. Okay, something very similar. These are the primaries. Primaries are, you know, the workhorses. They are the ones which actually do all the work.
Okay.
And so they are very tough. You can see this feather. Very tough. And this is also a primary feather. And probably of the left wing only. See? Can you see this?
Mm.
It is toughened. It is already in an aerodynamic form. Each individual feather also is like an aerofoil. There it is. Yeah. Okay? So, the primary feather of the left wing. You can all identify now?
Yeah.
Okay? This one? What is this? Again of a left wing. Here. Okay? This is somewhere a secondary feather. Okay, of I think a spotted eagle or something. Okay? These are the primaries. Next. All the primaries lined up there for you. Next. See this. See the beautiful arrangement of feathers here. Probably this is probably an egret, one of the. Okay? Can you see the how the wing, the feathers are overlapping? Here. Okay? And can you also notice that there are more number of feathers here to make that, you know, give that shape? Okay, give the thickness to the aerofoil. Okay, and this is what is an engineering marvel. And you will notice that when the bird actually flaps down, they are all together, and when it flaps up, the feathers open up like this, like the Venetian blinds, so as to allow the air to pass through, so that the movement can be very easy. Okay? And when it comes down, all the feathers are again together overlapping. There is no leakage of wind or airflow when it is flapped down.
Okay. Number of primaries per species, is it the same or is it the same?
Generally 10 is what is the same.
For all species.
For all species. Next. Okay, in this case, birds' forelimbs are modified into wings, and it is again, I already said this, you know, all framework of mothers, normal birds, and so on. Next. This is how it looks, a cross section. Okay, we have already seen this, the muscle is here, and there is one body part called the potassium, which actually is controlling, you know, which has got the control mechanism of the entire flight. Okay, those birds which are left in the zoo, okay, this particular element is cut so that they no longer fly. Okay, potassium is severed for those which are placed in the zoos and whatever.
That is cartilage?
No, actually it is a nervous something to do with the nervous system. All the nerves, the control of the hand goes through it. Something like a cartilage, but that is what has got the control for the entire wing control. Next. Okay, now you can see this. Can you feel that? You know, it is actually not flat. Pardon me, sir.
Sorry.
was asking when there is cut, it is not painful for the bird?
Probably it is painful, but it will learn to live like that way. That's a very sad part of it, but a bird without flight certainly is. And can you all feel the aerofoil here? Okay, it's not just flat, it is actually the shape that I have shown you. Now we also have the tail of the of each bird. Okay, tail has a definite function to get that aerodynamic contouring that I was talking about. Okay, here it is shown in through an experiment in a wind tunnel. Wind tunnel is a place where you can control the speed of the wind, and you have aerofoils placed inside, and you can observe through various apparatus that are fitted there. Okay, so that's how. Okay, so you can see that when this bird has got its tail, the drag component is, the disturbance of the airflow is very minimal. When you cut its tail and some part of the tail, the drag has actually increased. So the tail actually does balance in flight, it helps in aerodynamic streamlining, and also it controls the activities in flight. Certain birds, which are predominantly flying in the night, have developed the art of flying silently. How do they do it? Like owls, nightjars, frog moths, etc. They have serrated edges. That means the edges are unlike that of the normal bird. They have certain serrations. That means it is rough at the edge. It is not clean. This roughness actually allows the bird to cancel that, that noise that comes because of the passing of the airflow. So, and we know that hornbills, when they fly, you can actually hear them flying before you see them. This is a normal bird, and this is an owl bird, owl feather. You can see the serrations, and in the case of the normal bird, it is smooth. Next. Okay, now coming to the shapes, wing shapes. You all have seen all the birds that are there. Probably no two birds are alike as far as the platforms are. This is what is called the platform. Platform means when you view the bird from above, when the bird has stretched its wings completely and you view it from above, what shape do you see is what is called the platform. I am seeing the platform view of these birds. So the one that on the top is something that of an albatross or a petrel, which have got long slender wings to take advantage of the wave currents. The broad soaring, something like all these eagles and the vultures. The high speed wings, typical of the geese, and the elliptical wings, typical of all the small birds like munias, sparrows, and things like that.
The region is different, isn't it? There is a
pigeon. No, ma'am, it will fall in this fourth category, the pigeon, or the third category. Something similar to the geese. No, it may appear to you in certain flight, but when you spread it, probably. Now, just to correlate how control actually happens in the air. We are flying, but I want to turn right, or I want to turn left, or go down, go up. How control actually happens? We have on the wings called the ailerons, the control surfaces which move up and down. On the elevator, we have, on the tail plane, we have the elevators, and on the fin, the vertical, we have what is known as the rudder. So next, so rudder, when I move the rudder, generally in an aeroplane, the rudder controls are at the feet. I move my left foot forward, the aeroplane will go left. That is how the controls are attached actually. It is universal. For simplicity's sake, I am just, so when I move my left, forward. The rudder is like this, it actually deflects to the left only. Alright? And when if I move my right foot forward, the rudder which is here, it deflects to the right. So that's moving the aeroplane to the, swing the aeroplane to the right. The elevator, which is at the tail, the joystick which is there in the cockpit, you pull the stick back, the elevators rise from behind, taking the aeroplane up, you push it forward, it goes down. And the same joystick, if I move it to the left aileron comes up, the right one goes down, and then I am able to turn left and like that. Okay? Similarly, next. Okay, now the control effectiveness, how well I can turn fast or how slow I can turn, depends on the size and shape of the control. Bigger the control surface, the more the effectiveness. The deflection angle, higher the angle, more the control. And again, it is related to the speed. More the speed, more the control again. And the distance of that control from where I am applying. The moment arm is called. Next. Okay, birds are different from fishes and aircraft, because even in fishes also, you know, the controls are almost similar to that of an aircraft. However, the birds use a variety of control mechanisms. Tail and wings do the functions of the fin to such an extent. Now, how do they control? The birds control using the primaries and also the secondaries. Okay, how well they are controlling and all that is still a matter of, you know, investigation, and it is still being studied. The tail which is there, okay, it has got feathers, 6 to 8. However, the tail is also used to control in this manner. Then head and body movement. You can see actually birds swinging their head and thus able to turn the way they want to turn, especially when they are flying through thick bush and, you know, jungles. And faster movement of one wing than the other, that is basically they are capable of reducing the surface area, or increasing the surface area, or reducing the surface area, thus creating a differential lift and thus turn. Next. Gliding flight is very, very similar to that of an aircraft, except that the bird uses its potential energy. That means it's already at a height, or it has gone up there because of thermals, and it is continuously gliding. Whereas in the case of an aircraft, it is the engine that is powering it. Here, the bird is converting the potential energy into kinetic energy. Now, there is one term that I want to introduce here, which is called stall. Stall, we all generally use this word. Okay, in aerodynamics parlance, stall means you have lost your lift. Okay. So, the bird, the wing, as you increase the wing, the aircraft is flying this way. It is the same for the bird wing also. Okay, aircraft is flying this way, and as you keep increasing the angle this way, there is a separation of flow that happens. That means the wing at some stage doesn't produce any lift. It will have produced the maximum lift, out of which suddenly it will stop producing. That is when the aeroplane will stall. When it stalls, it loses height. And there are stall recovery procedures, you know, which you have to take. And in case you don't do that, the aeroplane may result in crash. Similarly for the bird also. Okay, bird also experiences this particular situation on a day-to-day basis. However, the birds know it. They do a fantastic job. You never see a bird falling.
So what does it do to its wing when it wants to stall, when it wants to lose?
Primarily, it comes, this particular situation comes the stall situation comes when the bird is just about to come and land, because that is the time when you want more maximum lift.
Yeah. So what does it do to its wing when it wants to lose height?
Lowers. When it wants to avoid stall, it will lower the angle.
Okay.
So unit. Whereas, you know, for a pilot sitting in the aircraft, this particular, you know, this indication may not come. It may not come till the time he starts, you know, looking at his altimeter and then finding out that, you know, he is losing height. Okay.
So that eagle is actually soaring very high.
Yeah.
It's just from the basis of the wing that
point.
So he glides and also.
Yeah, it is soaring. That is what it is soaring.
It's going in front of
circles.
So it's gaining height on the wing.
Correct.
It is just over there.
It is gaining height because there is a current, rising current of air that is there.
Okay.
It is continuously staying in that fountain of air that is going up. So automatically the air is taking it up. It is using that.
If it moves from that location
to elsewhere, it won't be able to sustain that. It won't be able to keep gaining height. So it will, at some stage, you know, all these fountains of hot air are not there all the places. Yes. They are there, you know, depending on the type of topography that is there. Right. Especially if it's a rocky area or, you know, it is all relative again.
Water bodies also?
Water bodies set to certain extent, but it is all relative. Okay. So this is what is called thermal, and if this happens to come into this fountain, it automatically go up. Even the aircraft also. If it comes by any chance into this kind of thermal, even the aircraft also goes up. It's got no choice.
When you're stalling
and
thermal, so you're saying that, do we also have air pocket
in the definition? The air pocket is actually this only. So, when we say pocket of air, means it is a certain volume of air that has got some characteristics which are similar. That means either it is, what should I say, it has got, say I am travelling from place A to B, okay, and all the way I am continuously getting a wind of say 10 kilometers per hour against me. Suddenly I find, after going travelling halfway or some place, I have found that the wind is not actually coming from head on. I find it is coming from my left beam, and again it disappears. So this is an air pocket. It's a pocket of air that has got a different characteristic than what it is. It is as simple as that. So here also, when we say thermals, people refer it as air pocket also, because the rest of the air surrounding this place is all calm. It is only doing horizontal movement, whereas this particular fountain of air is doing vertical movement. So we call it a pocket. When we get into this pocket, we rise. And where this goes, as long as the temperature doesn't equal with the surrounding air. The moment it equals, we stop. And then again, in case you don't stay in this fountain, you will lose height again. So this is what happens. Okay, stall. Now, next. So, when there is airflow on the aerofoil like this, at some place on the aerofoil, there will be certain disturbances because of the increased velocity on the top. Okay? And there, because of this disturbance, and as you keep increasing, the disturbance only increases. And if there is disturbance, that means what is happening? The velocity, there is no more, no increased velocity here. Basically, it is a comparison. And since there is no increased velocity, what is happening? The pressure, the reduced pressure that was supposed to be there is no more there. So that is why the aerofoil loses lift. That is exactly what is stopped.
Basically,
that streamline. Yeah, the streamline flow of air must continue. That will be disturbed if you keep increasing the aerofoil angle. Next. See here, the angle is increased too much here. Can you see how much angle? Almost 40 degrees. at this stage we are creating. You know, these eddies, they are called eddies, you know, these disturbances. And when it creates these disturbances, there is no more lift here possible and the wing loses height. And these eddies actually cause the feathers to ruffle of the bird. Okay? The birds of the, you know, the feathers of the bird get ruffled because of these eddies. As long as the flow is laminar and smooth, the bird is fantastic. But when there is a disturbance, the feathers are being ruffled. Each feather is connected, you know, nervous system wise. And the bird knows, yes, there is some ruffling going on. That means I am reaching stall. I must reduce my angle.
In some fighter jets,
yeah,
the angle of attack to the wing sometimes goes to 90 degrees also.
Yeah.
So how is this?
That is only temporary. It doesn't go to 90 degrees. What happens is maximum, even in the flattest and the latest aircraft also, is around 60 degrees or so.
So the stalling doesn't take place over there?
No, it does take place. Okay. However, when you mean that it is 90 degrees, it is actually not. When you do it rapidly, you know, without maintaining the same plane, if this is the flight path, as long as I am raising this wing, maintaining this flight path, then only then the angle of attack is increasing. If I am doing the loop, each time the angle is taken from the new relative airflow. Okay, so it can never be 90.
So stand it sure at every point.
Yeah, correct. Okay, except when you maintain level flight. Okay, so that's what it is. So
diving which people do, paragliding people do, is the same technique or the same concept?
The wing is the same concept. The wing that they use, the parachute that they use, actually is a wing.
Before parachute is released,
yeah,
they sustain in the air for some time.
Free fall.
So how is it possible that?
No, it is a free fall. It is a free fall.
Yeah.
It is a free fall.
So it's the same concept going on over there.
No, free fall is entirely different. We are not discussing that subject at all. Because it is just a body which is falling. Probably you will be able to maneuver and control using, you know, these days you got these webs which have come.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
The new suits that have come in the skydivers.
Yes.
Okay, they wear a suit which is connecting the arms with the hip here.
Yes.
So you can extend it, okay, to make a wing. Okay.
Yeah, yeah,
so these kind of things have come. However, when a skydiver jumps out of the aircraft, it is just a free fall. And he is enjoying himself.
But when the plane somersaults during these shows,
yeah,
the control is at the wing level or at the rudder here,
then
somersaults?
When it is doing a loop,
yeah,
he is purely doing it using the stick. Because generally what happens is you in the fighter jets that all the time, even the airliners that we all fly, the rudders are very rarely used. It is always maintaining strength. So here, the bird knows that so and so feathers are getting ruffled. Okay, so it takes corrective action immediately. So you will never see a bird stalling. Next. Okay, see this. Okay, we'll just discuss this. This is the aerofoil, and it is smoke that is being shown just to see what is actually happening on the aerofoil. Okay, this is a flash. Continue, it is going. Yeah. Can you see the upper surface, the air has speeded up than the lower surface. Can you see this?
Yeah.
So that proves my point, Bernoulli's theorem. So there is low pressure on the top, relatively high pressure, the wing wants to go up to occupy that low pressure. Now what happens, increasing the angle of attack, let's see. Okay, the aerofoil turns up. Have you seen the aerofoil turning up? See how the acceleration is taking place. How that streamlines have come closer. And I keep increasing the angle of attack. See how that airflow is getting disturbed. Now it is got separated all the time, completely. This is the point of stop. Okay, there is no more lift now. The airfoil will just lose height. Next. You can see this? That has ruffled here. Okay, just at the any time there a bird is landing, it wants maximum lift. Okay, why it wants maximum lift? Because I always want maximum lift to ensure my high touchdown at zero speed. I want to touch down. Idea is, any time you are doing a takeoff, next I'll come to that. Next. Again, you can see feathers ruffled. Next, here again. Next, we'll come to that a little later. We'll talk about takeoffs and landings. Next, please read. Okay, the basic difference somebody has already brought out from the audience, that we don't have an engine. Okay, so we need to do both lift and thrust from the wings, unlike an aircraft. And flapping action of the bird is the one that does this. Next. The bird flaps its wing down. When it is flapping its wing down, the relative motion, the relative wind is coming from below, because see, I am moving the wing down like this. Where am I feeling the wind coming from, airflow coming from? From below, correct? If I do this, it is from here. If I do this, it is from here. So when the bird flaps, it is from below. That's what it is. Okay, the wing must end from above during the upstroke, correct? So the wing is continuously flexing around its longitudinal axis, so that every time it gets the correct angle to meet the airflow. Next. While lift and propulsion both are produced in the downstroke, which is the power stroke, the bird basically draws its power by flapping down, and the wing is powered down with its edge tilted down. When the edge is tilted down, what happens? Certain amount of thrust that I gained from here, when it is tilted, there is a component this way forward which takes the bird forward. Okay, resolution of vectors. I have certain force going this way. The moment I tilt it this way, I have an additional vector which has come in the forward direction, which is actually helping me in accelerating the bird forward. Okay. Here you can see this. Okay, you can actually see the wing is tilted down, the relative wind coming from here, thrust is forward, and this is the total reaction. That means this is the total reaction that of the wing, which is split into lift and thrust. Okay, clear? Next. See, downstroke. The bird is struggling. This is a Marabou stork. They are flying.
Marabou
stork. Okay. This photograph taken by me when I was in Congo. Next. Then the outer wing opens like a Venetian blind, like I have already said, and air passes and lowers the resistance and thus reducing the drag. This is what happens during the upstroke. Next. See? In the upstroke, can you see this? Open. Okay, next.
Was it the same bird?
Yeah, it's the same bird. I got a sequence of all the, I got, I think, 12 shots which I can show it to you in sequence. Of the same bird taking off and doing a landing, a short hop. Downstroke.
Sure.
Upstroke, can you see this opening up?
Yeah.
Interesting, the tail feathers as the.
Yeah, now see this again open.
The tail feathers are opened up.
Yeah. Next. Yes. This is 300 frames per second. Sorry, I think next. I think it's too heavy for my computer. Okay, now coming to takeoff and landings. Takeoff means I want to transfer my body weight from my legs onto my wings. Similarly, landing is transferring my body weight from the wings onto the legs. Okay? And birds, it has been always observed that they always take off and land into wind. Why? We'll see. Okay? Idea of takeoff and landing is, I want to take off at zero speed. Like, I'm standing here, the bird is standing here, it wants to take off from there itself, from zero speed, and land at zero speed. Okay, it is probably possible if the thrust to weight ratio, that means if the bird has got fantastic power in its wings, okay, it is possible. Like you can see the sparrows, these pigeons that you see, they are all at one place. If they decide to fly, they just take off. Okay, and they come and land, you know, flapping like hell, they come and land at that place, wherever they want to. But that is what is desirable. Even in an aircraft, I want an aircraft to take off just like that, you know, from wherever it is. I want a helicopter over my house, rooftop. You know, I want to go wherever I want to go and come and land there whenever I want to. That is what it is. That's what the bird also wants. However, it may or may not be possible depending on what is the thrust to weight ratio. If I have the thrust that can take on my weight, it is possible. If it is not there, just too bad. Then what do we do? We start running to get that. Okay? And at the same time, I want maximum speed in flight. I want to land and take off at zero speed. However, I want to travel at the speed of sound. Now, that is these are all desirables, but however, it may not happen. Okay? Next. When the bird takes off from a perch, it is just diving itself. Okay? From perch, converting its potential energy into kinetic energy and gliding and flapping and doing whatever it is. And when it takes off from ground, it has to flap to generate an adequate lift and thrust. Next. Okay. Now, why they take off and land into wind, I will explain here. Okay. So, let us say a bird can continue to fly at a speed of 11 kilometers per hour without stalling. That means its stalling speed is 11 kilometers per hour. That means any time it goes less than that, it will lose height. So, to maintain level flight, it has to maintain speed more than 11 kilometers. Now, for takeoff, the bird has to do anything to get that 11 kilometers per hour. Only then it will maintain its weight on the wings. Otherwise, it won't be able to take off. Understanding me? Suppose if I am facing into a wind of headwind of 8 kilometers per hour, that means how much do I have to work? I just have to start walking at 3 kilometers per hour. 8 plus 3, 11. Correct? So it is. I have saved some energy. If I had 11 kilometers headwind and I am with my wings, okay, completely extended, what will happen? I will start, you know, feeling light on my body. And probably if it is 12 kilometers, I will start going up at the same place. Okay, have you noticed this? Probably you will notice, okay, henceforth, okay, this is what actually happens. So birds, they are very very energy conscious. Okay, so they want the maximum returns for their whatever food they eat. Okay, so that's how this. And you will see mostly, except for the small birds which are sparrows and all, which have got very high thrust to weight ratio, rest of all of them will take advantage of this. And you will see that the birds generally do not land into tail wind. They will always land into wind only again. Because again, this same factor applies there. Next. Okay. Heavy birds need a takeoff run. We have all seen this. In Gujarat and wherever you have been, all these flamingos, geese, ducks, vultures, okay, they all run on the field and gather enough speed, you know, get their wings lift worthy, and then only can they leave the ground. Similarly, tailwind has got negative effects. You keep running in tailwind, you will have to run for your takeoff speed plus this additional tailwind that is there, okay, which is not possible. Okay. Similarly, that's why all the aircraft, you know, any airport, all the aeroplanes take off only into wind. Because that's why you will see sometimes you are landing from this side in Samshabad and sometimes you are landing from the other side.
I would like to reach out there. Sorry. There is a problem with the ocean river, it seems. So, if anyone...
Sorry?
There is a bomb blast at Kedarshan Nagar, if there was sometime back. Just for an information.
If anybody is going towards that place, so please rush up to your place.
Call,
it's
everywhere. You must know the rest. We just wanted to give you information.
This is an accident.
Whatever. Thank you.
Sorry for the accident.
Okay. So, tailwind has got a very very negative effect. Okay, a lot of there's so many landing accidents that have taken place in the aviation history in the last 110 years because of this. Okay, lots of lives have been lost. And hard landings can be noticed in birds also, if you see. And stormy winds can actually drain out a bird because, you know, it is not getting a chance to land. It is so turbulent and the wings probably wear out. Next. Okay, same understanding the wind. Now if I am flying from A to B and say if a bird is flying from A to B, okay, and there is a wind of 40 kilometers per hour headwind for that bird, is okay, its effective ground speed. In this case, if it is flying at 100 kilometers, in this case, if it is going from A to B, it will be 60, and if it is coming back from there, it will add up and it will become 140. So this is the effect of wind that has got, that is there on the bird or even the aircraft. So these are same. You can see all of them lined up because the winds are from that side. They are all taking off in the same. This phenomenon probably you all would have noticed. They all generally take off in the same. This is the shot taken in Masai Mara. Next. See this? See this? Yeah. See this? Pretty.
Okay.
Only for takeoff and landing. After after that you can go and then do a turn and then go downwind, then take advantage of the wind, let it carry. You will always see, actually if you see crows and all these birds landing around your house, you will actually see, if you notice these days, winters, the winds are westerlies, okay? You can always see, you know, birds landing into west, all over. Now, coming to landing. When at the point of landing, it is I want to transfer my weight from the wings onto the feet. Now I require all the kind of lift that is possible. So how do I get maximum lift? Is I completely extend my wing, make maximum surface area. Because to land, I am as it is reducing my speed, correct? So when I reduce my speed, my lift is going to reduce. But I want to compensate for landing at, you know, at the minimum possible speed, what will I do? So, the bird will use the maximum area to, that's why any landing photograph you will see, you know, wings are completely, you know, extended so as to get the maximum possible amount of this thing. And also, you know, by, you know, increasing, they also increase the angle of attack, again increasing the lift, and then they recurve their body more so that more lift can be produced. All these aspects are there. Okay. There's some more aerodynamic terms like flaps and other things which you keep seeing when the aircraft is landing, you know, any airliner that you sit next to a wing, at the time of landing you will see that there are sheets coming out of that wing. Okay? That is actually doing this only. It is increasing the wing area and also the camber. So you will have a more acceleration on your wing, thus more lift at the same time, increasing the drag and reducing your landing speed. That's what it is. Next. Similarly, you see here, you know, he is extended the air brake to reduce the speed, okay, he has put the flaps down, undercarriage down, all that. So, the same thing happens in an aircraft also. Next question. You can see this? The wing fully extended, a landing sequence. Portion of the wing which is extending forward also, okay, thereby creating a slot so that air can enter from the underneath and, you know, re-energize the layer. Next, this is what you all see now when flying. Next, this is how a flap works. The flap which is actually extended and comes down, that's how increasing the area and also the camber, that means the angle. Next. Next, we'll come to this. Okay, now we have something called the alula. Alula or the magic wing. Okay. It's basically the thumb of the bird. Okay. Now what the thumb of this bird does is, it extends the thumb so that it encloses the airflow that is coming under it, as if through a slot, and then because of this slot, this airflow gets accelerated, and since it gets accelerated, okay, it creates more lift. So this alula is deployed especially at the time of landing, when it requires, when a bird requires a little additional lift to reduce its speed. Okay, next, you can see the pigeon. The alula. Okay, this is a lift augmentation device. It is actually increasing its lift by just extending its thumb. Okay, it re-energizes, increases the speed, and thus it will increase the lift also and delay the stall also. Next, can you see this? next. Okay, we've seen, you know, some certain birds which sweep their wings and, you know, for a dive. Even in a kingfisher, when it is hovering and suddenly wants to plunge into water, it will sweep its wings back and thus enter a dive. Why does it do so? Next. That is the peregrine falcon, okay? See, here also. Now we have certain aircraft which can do the same in air. Okay, this is one of the American aircraft, F-111. Even in Indian Air Force, we have aircraft which can sweep wings like this. Yeah. This is a 111. F-111. We have V-27s in the Air Force, which can sweep their wings this way. Okay. Now, in this condition and in this condition, there is a differential lift that is produced. Here, the wings are extended across and there it is swept by almost 60 degrees here. So, lift for a simple recognition, it is directly proportional to the cosine of the sweep angle. Okay? So, if my wing is like this, if my wing is like this, which is 90 degrees to the airflow, I get maximum lift. And if I sweep my wing this way and continue to fly that way, my lift will reduce in ratio of cosine of this particular sweep angle, this angle. Okay? So, I am actually trying to reduce my lift. Why? Because I am going to increase my speed. My speed is increasing, V square. I am going to increase my lift and compensate for my lift by increasing my speed. So, these are the aircraft which when they have to go supersonic, they flush their wings, sweep their wings back and thus go supersonic. Otherwise, if they continue to stay in this position, they will not be able to sustain the material fatigue of the air forces of the airflow. So, I want more speed, so I reduce my wing area. So, that is how peregrine falcon is able to attain a speed of 417 kilometers per hour in a dive. 240 miles.
Sir, miles, correct.
Miles. So, that is the way it is. So, I sweep the wings and then achieve more speed. Next. Okay, reduce the surface area and also reduce the angle at which you are striking the air. Next. We have another phenomenon called the wingtip vertices. What happens is, we all know while it is flying, I am looking from the rear of the aircraft now. We are all looking at the rear side of the aircraft. And the aircraft is flying away from us. So what happens? There is low pressure on the top, high pressure at the bottom. Here again there is low pressure and high pressure. So, air would like to escape from high pressure to low pressure, correct? It would like to go and occupy a place of vacuum or partial vacuum. So, we have something called the vertices. There is a vertex that is generated all along like this. Okay? And bigger the wing, and heavier the wing, the weight of the aircraft, these vertices are stronger and radially increasing in size. Okay, this is what is called a wing tip vertex. So this actually, while the wing is, you know, we want very high, very low pressure here and very high pressure here and for greater lift. And similarly, the vertex also will be such of great magnitude, and this vertex is doing nothing but creating drag. This is what is lift dependent drag that we talked about in the beginning. Okay, lift induced drag or lift dependent drag. So now how to get rid of this? Okay, the birds, we will learn it from the birds. Next. Okay, here again, same. See here, there is a fence, I created a fence on the wing, so I should stop this rotation. the air from below coming and striking you. Okay, next. This is single fort in the background. Next. Now, I'll show you an aircraft which has got a fence to stop this vortex and which doesn't have a fence. On one wing, on the left wing, there is no fence. On the right wing, there is a fence. Now, can you see the vortex size and shape? There is a credible reduction that side. That's how we have reduced the drag. Next. The birds also do this. Okay. Again, a marabou shark flying around. Next. See this. Okay. The picture speaks for itself. Next. We all seen this. The birds flying over water, we are hugging the water, almost the water surface, and flying around. Cormorants, pelicans like this. Okay, why do they do this? Again,
fish.
Okay, energy consumption. Okay, next. You see this? Flying over water, the geese. Next. What actually, how we learned this is, now when an aeroplane is coming into land, we are following this particular flight path. I'm coming with my engines on, all my flaps down, undercarriage down, the wheels down, everything down. I am following this. But when I have come to touchdown, very close to the runway, I am not touching down. The aeroplane continues to fly along the runway for some more distance. Instead of touching down here. That is when we have realized there is something else happening when we are close to ground. Okay? Then we have found out that next. At a height of about half the wingspan, this is wingspan. Okay? At half the wingspan from here to here. Somewhere around here, that means if a Boeing or an Airbus is landing, the wingspan is almost say 45 meters, half the wingspan around 22 meters. Right? When it comes to a height of around 22 meters, 20 meters, that is when it is hitting the same vertex that we talked about. Okay, here. Okay, this vertex, instead of the fence there, here it is now being obstructed by the ground, the proximity of the ground. The vertex is getting nullified. And there is a high pressure under the wing here. So it is not allowing the aircraft to now settle down. Okay. So thus it is reducing the drag and allowing that aircraft to go further. Unless we reduce power here at this stage, the aircraft won't touch down. It will continue to fly parallel to the runway. Okay. So this is what we have learned while we have flown. We are flying. The birds have learned it long before. Okay, so you will see the cormorants and pelicans and all these birds, they fly very close to the water, they are almost hugging and going because they know how to break this vortex and there is considerable energy saving in this. So very long distances they fly. Next, see this, pelicans, Lake Nakuru, Kenya.
Water, not over ground.
Because, not over ground, because on the ground you have so many obstructions coming around. And ultimately the bird will move out of its wingspan, half the wingspan. So that's it. It is very, very easy to do it over water. Okay. Mean pelicans, they are great. Not pelicans.
Flamingos.
Great little flamingos. Lake Nakuru. Next. See this? Your photograph. The cormorant. You always see a cormorant sitting, after it has finished its meal, it comes, perch there and dry its wings. Primarily because the cormorant doesn't have the preen gland that I have told you. Okay, it can't oil its wings. if it oils its wings, the buoyancy would increase and it won't be able to dive into the water 20-30 meters where it goes to fish. So the cormorant's wings are non-oiled to allow it, and it doesn't take in any air. If it encloses air, it wouldn't be able to dive to those 20-30 meters that it goes. So the cormorant will always dive, finish its meal, eat, and come again, dry its wings for next flight or whatever, and to also to regulate its body temperature.
When it is trying to come out of water, it must be feeling very heavy.
It flies inside. It flaps inside to come out. The feet are webbed. It swims inside. Combination of swimming and flying.
But in the absence of oil, the water will stay and make it heavy.
That's why it is drying. You don't see other birds drying their wings. Generally, most wings are to a certain extent waterproof. They can fly in rain also. Okay, pouring flight we have all seen. Okay, the sunbirds doing it on a daily basis around us. Next. Now it is a very, very complex flight. The flight itself is complex and pouring flight is extremely complex. Though I am a helicopter pilot, okay, it is unimaginable to see the kind of the wing work that is going on in slow motion. Okay, it is both forward, rearward, front and back. Okay, but very difficult to understand this. So we leave it at that. But I just want to tell you that the hovering flight is, the bird uses its wings like a propeller to stay at that place. Next. Next, coming to formation flying. Next. You see all kinds of formations at some stage or the other. Next. Video grab from the last lecture. Again, sir, here the dynamics of formation flight. Okay, I have read so many contradicting articles and explanations as to why these birds fly in this manner. Next. Okay. However, there are certain advantages of flying in a formation, which are the general ones. Here, you teach the young ones, you know, to go together. Ease of navigation, because there is one lead aircraft which is doing the navigation. Rest all are following. Share duties like hunting for food or looking out for prey, for predators, prey and predators both. And cooperation, communication, and there is safety in numbers. These are the general advantages. There are certain aerodynamic advantages which are there. However, I do not want to communicate them to you because there is some kind of an inconclusive report. People say there is saving in the energy consumed, the greater distances can be traveled, what not. But however, there is no concrete proof because we are still unable to make aircraft, these birds fly in a wind tunnel, in a formation, to actually study them. So it is a subject which will probably will be unraveled in years to come.
Okay. They don't flap in synchrony, is it?
They have learnt which exact distance to maintain wing and
exactly.
What is the distance from wingtip to wingtip they must maintain. All that is there. Generally, probably if you do some studies, we'll be able to get it. However, I do not want to speculate anything or give you any incorrect information. Okay, so that is why I have just listed out what are the general advantages in while flying in a formation. This is what we also experience when we are flying in a formation.
We
have
one question.
Sir.
Besides, when to tell?
Again, you know, this after observing those rosy starlings, okay, it has been conclusively proved that it, the birds always turn into the flock. That has been, you know, after watching these rosy murmurations, and the scientists have conclusively proved that they will always turn into the flock. So that probably that is what, probably that is a safe way of flying. But we need to do a lot of study on this. Next. Okay, risk of flightlessness. You know, you will be taken for a ride. Okay. That is in the ostrich farm outside Nairobi, Kenya. Next.
Is this a long
record?
You can take the vehicle
from there? Yeah, we have ostrich races also. Like Polakar races, ostrich.
Again, the bird, you can stand on an ostrich egg, it doesn't break.
Okay, and we have dodo. Extinct forever. Next.
I mean, this is the
future of man, isn't it? You can't fly straight to be dead as a dodo. I don't know. Next. So if you have any queries, you can revert to me.
Thank you.